Recently, the Philippines, led by Finance Secretary Cesar Purisima, chaired the Climate Vulnerable Forum in Lima, Peru. There, the V20 was launched. It's a group of the most vulnerable nations to climate change, including the Philippines. Now, the Aquino administration launched its call for proposals to access the People's Survival Fund. It's a fund available to communities and groups wanting to adapt to climate change. Carmina Constantino sat down with Secretary Purisima, and they talked about the importance of finance in the fight against climate change.
Tell us more about your experience in Lima, Peru, where you chaired that climate vulnerable forum.
Well, it was a very important meeting because it was a gathering of the 20 countries that are most vulnerable to the effects of climate change. Among them are countries that may disappear if the temperature rises 2 degrees in the next 20 to 30 years. Maldives, Tuvalu, Kiribati. So these are existential and viability issues for millions of people. The other thing worth noting about these 20 countries is that almost half of the population are in poverty. And that is why I think it's correct to point out that the issue of poverty and climate change can be intertwined. In the case of our experience in Haiyan or Yolanda, a lot of our fellow citizens who were near poor slid back to poverty because they lost their houses, their businesses. And therefore, we really need to do something about it in several ways. One, really work to prevent the additional damage to our environment. And agree to reduce carbon emissions, which is the primary cause of climate change. Two, agree on risk pooling. Now, because the countries that are most vulnerable, the 20 of which we're part of and we're chairing the group, are not the primary culprits to this. And therefore, we need to go beyond aid to really come up with permanent mechanisms that are viable. Let me give you an example. Again, using our experience during Yolanda, we need insurance mechanisms. Now, because the poorest of the poor were naked. They, you know, when they lost everything, they had nowhere to go but the government or the aid agencies.
They're even poorer now than where they started.
Exactly, and therefore we must come up with viable insurance mechanisms. And insurance, by its very nature, can only be viable if it is large scale. Not just one country, but many countries in different parts of the world. Second is in terms of infrastructure. A country like us that's trying to catch up in terms of needed infrastructure is using hard-earned resources to build irrigation, bridges, school buildings, hospitals, etc. And then one typhoon can destroy that. And therefore, we need to come up again with insurance schemes to do this and other risk-pooling schemes. The world, I think, is now more conscious about the effect of climate change. I don't think they're debating anymore. No? In Lima, we had in attendance Helen Clark, the president of the World Bank, representatives from key partners. So we're hoping that we can come up with an aggressive proposal to the V20 and to the COP21 meeting in Paris.
Mr. Secretary, when you talk about climate change, usually the participants there are usually NGOs, other concerned parties. But what happened in Lima was the first time that we ever saw finance ministers from all over really just pushing for this issue and for this agenda. Why is it important that finance ministers of different countries take the lead in the fight against climate change?
Well, obviously the fight against climate change will require a lot of resources, and at the heart of resources is money. And as you know, the finance minister's job is to make sure that the resources are generated and allocated. For example, the world leaders, the world community has agreed to raise $100 billion a year to fight climate change starting 2020. So far, of that 100 there's about 68 that's committed, and we need 32 more. No, of the 68, there is criticism that some may just be reclassification of existing money. No, but let's take that as new money. No, the 32 need to be funded. No, in Lima, Christine Lagarde, the managing director of the IMF, came up with a proposal, and he says, we need to really bite the bullet on this. Maybe one thing we should consider is a tax on fuel used for international shipping and airlines. No, obviously, it will increase the cost of travel and the movement of goods. No, but these are a major contributor to carbon emissions that's affecting climate change. She also spoke about a way of properly pricing carbon. No? I think we need to go to, beyond talk to more walk, to more action.
But how difficult is it to institutionalize reforms here at home when you have about two dozen coal-fired power plants that's in the pipeline just waiting to be built? I mean, how difficult of a balancing act is that?
There are already technology that allows for very clean use of coal. Nevertheless, no, I think we can give the poorer countries some leeway, no? But there must be a program towards really the adoption of cleaner, renewable fuel. There is an effort on the part of the government to walk its talk here. We are targeting the reduction of 70% of our carbon footprint using 2000 as our baseline.
Let's talk about the PSF, People Survival Fund, a very important fund, very important law, yet not a lot of people know about it. How would you explain it in the simplest of terms? What is PSF all about and why should people care?
Well, it's a first step by government to put up a fund that can be used to fund projects that will help mitigate climate change. So it's funded. We are at a stage where we're asking for proposals from local government units and other entities. And under the law, once it's utilized, it will automatically be replenished. Now, and there, the hope is there's always be going to be a billion pesos in this fund. But mind you, this is just a small first step. No, there's the global climate plan fund globally that's quite substantial. I think you know, the estimate to climate proof the world is upwards of 90 trillion up to 2030. These are huge sums of money. The law and the estimate are also in the trillions. No, and therefore clearly preventive actions, I think, is the smartest thing to do. And preventive actions, I think, will require a change of behavior, a change of measurement tools. For example, our accounting system doesn't automatically capture the cost of economic activity to environment.
Right.
And, you know, there's a saying that what is not measured doesn't get done. And therefore, if we are serious about it, I think we should approach it from all dimensions, including the developing a new accounting model that actually measures the effect of economic activity to climate change.
Mr. Secretary, is it just about mitigation or adaptation as well? Do you think adaptation is more important than just mitigation?
I think it's a combination of both, no? Because you know, we need to already deal with the impact of the damage so far, no? And therefore we need to adapt. Now, for example, we're seeing extremely strong typhoons, no? In the U.S. Or in the Eastern or in the Americas, they recently had the Patricia, yeah, which was even stronger than Haiyan.
Yeah.
In the case of the Philippines, we've had our three deadliest typhoons the last five or so years. The last 14 years of the past 15 years has been the warmest ever. This year alone, we started with a very cold winter in the U.S. Northeast, and yet 7 or 6 of the first 8 months of the year have been the hottest ever in recorded history. And 2015 is destined to become the hottest year. So something's happening. And therefore, to mitigate the impact on us, we need to do a lot of things. No? One, we need to build back stronger and better, as the president would like to say, relocate the low-lying and vulnerable areas, come up with risk pooling and insurance mechanisms, but at the same time, slow down the impact of climate change by using new technology, by agreeing to reduce carbon emissions. Yeah.